Hello again, this is Professor Watts, and today we're going to talk about specialization and the division of labor. Now, if you're in the class, we will have just done the puzzle building activity. And if you're taking the class online, you will have just watched a video version of that where we observed that naturally, working in teams, we were able to increase productivity in terms of putting puzzles together, and we can kind of think of economic process as putting a puzzle of land, labor, and capital together to build goods and services. More on that forthcoming. But the real point of the puzzle activity was that not just that we produced more, but on a per-person basis, we became more productive. So a team of two people, for instance, was able to put the puzzle together in less than half the time. So with the same amount of time, and each individual can produce more of the good. And how was that accomplished? Well, that was accomplished by specializing. And a very common thing we observe in that puzzle building is that when I allow you two or three workers, one person will specialize in the edges, one person will specialize in the sky, one person will specialize in the little kitty cat's face, and so on. So by specializing, we gain a lot of productivity. And that's what we're going to be talking about today in a bit more formal sense. We're going to draw strongly on Adam Smith, one of the really the founding fathers of economics, one of the great thinkers in economics. And we'll make reference to his famous book, Inquiry into the Nature and Causes of the Wealth of Nations, from 1776. And it's really the very first thing he mentions. So for him, it's a starting point of his economics. So let's begin. Now, here's a quote from the book. And Smith says, "The greatest improvement in the productive powers of labor, and the greater part of the skill, dexterity, and judgment with which it is anywhere directed or applied, seem to have been the effects of the division of labor." Well, how does that work? Well, Smith starts off, as I mentioned, the very beginning of his book, with an example of a pin factory. And we're talking the kind of pins you use in sewing and making clothes. And back then, pins were very relevant because there wasn't a lot of ready-made garments, and most households would make most, if not all, of their own clothing. So these kind of pins used for sewing were in high demand, and every household would have to be stocked with them. Probably a more important article at that time, a more common article in an average home than it is even today. And let me just jump in here to chapter 1 of Smith, which is titled Of the Division of Labor, and I'm going to read about a page worth of this for you. He says, "To take an example, therefore, from a very trifling manufacture, but one in which the division of labor has been very often taken notice of, the trade of the pin maker. A workman not educated to this business, which the division of labor has rendered a distinct trade, nor acquainted with the use of the machinery employed in it, to the invention of which the same division of labor has probably given occasion, could scarce, perhaps, with his utmost industry, make one pin in a day, and certainly could not make 20. But in the way in which this business is now carried on, not only the whole work is a peculiar trade, but it is divided into a number of branches, of which the greater part are likewise peculiar trades. One man draws out the wire, another straights it, a third cuts it, a fourth points it, a fifth grinds it at the top for receiving the head. To make the head requires three distinct operations. To put it on is a peculiar business. To whiten the pins is another. It is even a trade by itself to put them into the paper. And the important business of making a pin is, in this manner, divided into about 18 distinct operations, which in some manufactories are all performed by distinct hands, though in others the same man will sometimes perform two or three of them. I have seen a small manufactory of this kind where 10 men only were employed, and where some of them consequently performed two or three distinct operations. But though they were very poor, and therefore but indifferently accommodated with the necessary machinery, they could, when they exerted themselves, make among them about 12 pounds of pins in a day. There are in a pound of upwards of 4,000 pins of a middling size. Those 10 persons, therefore, could make among them upwards of 48,000 pins in a day. Each person, therefore, making a tenth part of 48,000 pins might be considered as making 4,800 pins in a day. But if they had all wrought separately and independently, and without any of them having been educated to this peculiar business, they could certainly not each of them have made 20, perhaps not one pin in a day. Certainly not the 240th, perhaps not the 4,800th part of what they are at present capable of performing in consequence of a proper division and combination of their different operations." So says Adam Smith. So what we observe is a huge increase in productivity by dividing up a manufacturing process into many steps and then bringing people in to specialize in those particular steps. Here's an illustration of some kind of wire goods factory. I don't know if this is pins per se, but you kind of get this idea here. You see some people here are working on the machines that draw the wire out. These guys over here might be cutting it into little bits. This person here might be polishing or grinding or sharpening. Okay, this guy over here is doing something else. So we see that we've divided the process up into several steps, and you can see illustrations of the different equipment they have down here. This is kind of the time period and the type of work that Adam Smith was chronicling there in his book. A tremendous increase in productivity based on dividing up a task and then having people specialize. Smith is going to go on in the first chapter of the book to talk about what's driving this huge productivity gain, and he comes up with three reasons. First is skill. And Smith talks in particular about the increase of dexterity in every particular workman. And the idea is that by doing something a lot, you get good at it. Practice makes perfect, so to speak. So experience gets you skill, and then it gets you a lot more productivity than someone who's new or untrained in a particular task. You've probably heard the old expression, if you're a jack of all trades, you are a master of none. Well, this is the opposite of that. You only do one thing, you get eventually very good at it. This phenomenon has been pretty well documented, and there's a pretty famous book from several years ago called Outliers by Malcolm Gladwell. And he chronicled people who were very good in their particular fields, whether sports or the arts or business. He found something in common amongst these people, and which is going to be not at all surprising given what we just mentioned. Okay, and what we're talking about with outliers is people who are at the very extreme ends of a distribution, in this case a distribution of skill or talent. And if you're familiar with your normal bell-shaped curve here from statistics, we're talking about people at either end here. Okay, and most of your observations are going to occur within about two standard deviations either side of the mean. And we're talking people here three or four standard deviations out. There's a very small percentage of people way out here at the extreme ends. So if this were male heights in the U.S., the mean is something, if I remember, about 5'10", and the standard deviation, I think, is about 3 inches. So 34% would be within 3 inches, one standard deviation to the left, so from 5'7 to 5'10", and then another 34% would be one standard deviation to the right, so from 5'10 to 6'1". So you're talking about 68% of your people are within that 6-inch height range. And then if you went out to another standard deviation, so 5'4" up to 6'4", 96%. So almost everybody is clustered pretty closely around the middle. And when you're talking about extreme cases, like a Shaquille O'Neal over here at 7'1", or a Peter Dinklage over here at just 4'5", those are very rare. So of course height is mostly genetic, and that's not something you can acquire, but Gladwell's talking about acquired talents, which you can obtain through practice. He'll be talking about people up here at the very highly talented. What do they have in common? Well, here's the takeaway from the book. 10,000 hours of deliberate practice are required for mastery of a skill. And that's what Gladwell found, again, when he looked at extremely talented people in business, sports, the arts, music, etc. What that would work out to would be 20 hours a week for 10 years if you just average it over 10 years. But what he found is actually that most of the people he looked at had concentrated their 10,000 hours during their very young years and hence were able to perform at a high level for their entire adult careers. So I'll give you a couple examples from Gladwell's book. Name that famous rock group, picture here circa early 1960s. That's right, that's the Beatles, the very young Beatles. Well, they were performing in clubs in Germany in the early 60s, basically all night every night for a couple years, and they got their 10,000 hours in as a group together that way very early on, and hence once they hit the scene in the United States, they were already peak performers. They were very in tune with each other, very skilled, very harmonious, and that's what allowed them to really excel as a music group. Another example here, name that very young computer programmer. Microsoft on the screen there gives it away. That's Bill Gates, and he got his 10,000 hours of computer programming in by the time he was done with high school. He started at a very young age as a child, and he would spend his after-school hours and weekends writing computer code. Well, guess what? He had 10,000 hours in, and by the time he was out of high school, he was ready to start one of the most successful software businesses ever. So it makes perfect sense. You put more time in, you get very good at something. Now, note that practice is necessary but not sufficient, as we would say. Just putting 10,000 hours in is not going to make you a huge success. But Gladwell's point in the book is that without the 10,000 hours, you're not going to have the high talent level that would be required for huge success. The luck plays a role, maybe knowing people plays a role. So the Beatles got a big break. Gates had the tenacity to launch his own business and stick with it. So it's not just the practice, but the practice is required. Okay, so that idea of getting good at something through experience and practice is hugely important when it comes to talking about why we see huge productivity gains from division of labor and specialization. Now, moving on, the next thing Adam Smith talks about is time savings. This one I think is interesting, but it's not as important as the other two, so I'm going to spend just a little bit of time on it. And I'll give an example of a farmer. And if you know anything about agriculture, maybe 100 years ago or more in the U.S., there were more subsistence-type farms where they grew a mixed variety of crops and kind of were more self-sufficient than today. And so a farmer might have some crops, some vegetables, some dairy animals, some meat animals, and therefore the farmer had a lot of different tasks to perform on his own farm. Whereas today, farmers typically specialize. If you're a dairy farmer, you're just a dairy farmer. If you're a cattle rancher, you're probably just a cattle rancher. You don't grow vegetables as well. If you're a vegetable farmer, you probably don't have hogs and chickens in the back either. It's very developed and specialized. And Smith notes that the saving of time, which is commonly lost in passing from one species of work to another, well, if you think about that old type of farming, 100 plus years ago, where you had to do a little bit of everything, that slowed you down and it made you less efficient than a farmer who only does one type of task in a day. Not only does this kind of farmer lose the opportunity to maximize skill because he has to do five or six different tasks every day instead of just specializing in one or two, but he loses time switching from task to task, putting away the animals and the tools and getting out a new set of tools and moving around from location to location. Probably not the biggest factor, but it's relevant, and it is something to think about, you know, and it is very applicable in life and in management of your time and your business. You want to realize that if you try to do everything yourself, you lose time in moving about from task to task rather than specializing in only a few things. Okay, well, let's move on. And the third item in Adam Smith's explanation here, and this is probably the biggest, is capital, or what Adam Smith refers to as machinery, the use of machinery in production. Machinery that, as Smith says, facilitates and abridges labor, or labor-saving devices. And here's some examples from that were really revolutionary at Adam Smith's time. Things like mechanical weaving looms that brought huge increases in productivity in the production of cloth. The steam engine, which powered a lot of that machinery and a lot of other kinds of production, transportation. And that's the Industrial Revolution, which was just getting started, really. It was in its infancy when Adam Smith was writing and observing the world in the late 1700s. Go back to agriculture. I like looking at agricultural examples because the change has been so dramatic in the past 100 years. Even in the United States, it's been pretty dramatic in the past 70 or 80 years. So here we have a scene probably from the late 1800s of men harvesting probably wheat with what's called cradles. It's got a steel blade at the bottom, and then the forks, the tines of the tool here, catch the sheaves of grain that's cut, and then another group of people, or the same guys, might come back later and bind the grain into shocks, which then have to be loaded onto a wagon and taken back to a barn to be threshed. So you see a lot of men here taken to clear the field. There's a lot of tasks involved. And this is nothing like how grain is harvested today. Today, all those steps are done in one, in what's called a combine harvester. It combines the process of cutting and actually threshing the grain. It separates the little kernels of grain, the seeds, from the rest of the plant, and then it kicks the trash, the straw and whatnot, out the back. Okay, so here we have one man doing the work today of several men 100 years ago, and not only that, but he can do a lot more land in one shot than these guys could do. So I would guess that this guy here can do in a day what these six men here might have done in a week or more. Okay, so there's machinery, and that's one of the big factor that's making us more productive. Let me give another example. Here is a picture. The caption says, "The earth was removed in baskets in early California railroad construction scene." This is probably from the 1860s, I would guess. And you see these workers digging by hand and carrying dirt away in baskets on their backs. Of course, that's not how we do it today either in the developed world. We use this big earth-moving machinery. Caterpillar, D11 bulldozer, one of the biggest. And you can see it's doing the work of probably hundreds of men using these primitive methods here. Okay, so that's machinery making us more productive and, of course, giving us grounds for specialization. This is a pretty complex piece of equipment. It does take skill to operate these. I've worked in construction, and I've known people who are operators, and they are very skilled. They make good money because of it. So this fellow here, who's driving this machine, this is probably the only thing he does. He's very experienced, he's very skilled, and very productive because he's mixing his labor with machinery. So, we have specialization in the division of labor giving us huge gains in productivity. And Adam Smith noticed this several hundred years ago, and he pinned it down to three explanations. The fact that you gain skill and experience by focusing on one task, the fact that you save time in switching from one task to another, and then the fact that the use of machines allows you to both focus only on one task and to become much more productive in that task. And Adam Smith, elsewhere in the book Wealth of Nations, stated, "It is the great multiplication of the productions of all the different arts and consequence of the division of labor, which occasions in a well-governed society that universal opulence which extends itself to the lowest ranks of the people." So basically here he's saying that countries get rich if they have good institutions, that's the well-governed part, because they're able to achieve the division of labor and specialization. So in the next lesson, we're going to delve deeper into this idea of the division of labor, and we'll actually be able to prove mathematically how we can all be better off through the division of labor when it is combined with one of the most powerful concepts we have in economics, trade.